Good morning, everybody. First of all, let me begin by expressing my deep gratitude for the organizers of this highly innovative missiological conference. Missiology has come a long way from what it used to be. Now that we are talking about techno-sapiens in a networked era. For a theologian such as myself, this is a wonderful learning opportunity and also have my own mind expanded. And it is certainly an extraordinary privilege and joy for me to comment on Professor Ilia Delio's presentation. What is particularly appealing to me in her presentation is the engagement with one of my great theological heroes, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, who used to be a highly innovative thinker, as you already heard. In the honored tradition of medieval scholars, it suffices me to merely add a few side notes on the margins of this highly learned and insightful presentations. And should I critique or find any failure in professor's thought, it can be attributed to my own ignorance. Professor Delio considers a number of themes, but I have isolated or focused my brief remarks on three main ideas. First, she provides a thoughtful critique of the transhumanistic vision, and as an alternative, second, she recommends to us post-humanist vision, and finally, she finds a link between post-humanism and Teilhard de Chardin. First, transhumanism and post-humanism assessed. I couldn't agree more with the critique of transhumanism and its unlimited optimism about the future. Transhumanism, following the lead of modernity's liberal vision, is an utopia on steroids. One of the first such visions from the early 1970s came from the physicist Frank Tipler's and his idea of physics of immortality. It intuits the continuance of intelligent life as some kind of a computational process, even long after any kind of human intelligent life as we know it has vanished. Indeed, Tipler envisions that ultimately the infinite expansion of intelligence to everywhere here in the universe is possible. Often disguised as a scientific enterprise, these transhumanist utopian visions of cybernetic immortality, they don't have much scientific backup or support. Be that as it may, a fatal liability of transhumanism has to do with the denunciation of human embodiment. Transhumanists dream of an exit from embodiment into some kind of fancy virtual world of naked intelligence, as in computers, and that is the vision for everlasting life. Ancient Gnostics would applaud. The most disturbing aspect of this utopian dream is the confidence in defeating death and decay as the new hybrid humanity steps into everlasting life. There are so many philosophical, scientific, let alone theological problems in this post-biological transhumanist vision that it's useless even to begin a sustained critical analysis. From my point of view, the transhumanist vision is dead at its arrival. And I am embarrassed that even some theologians seem to find some kind of parallel between it and the Christian vision of resurrected life in the new creation. Happily, our speaker, our professor, does not belong to that group. Her seasoned and sharp critical assessment of transhumanism is worth citing here. Quote, "This narrow-minded binary way of thinking is shallow because it fails to recognize the integral relationship between mind and matter, which evolve together as a complex whole. Transhumanism induces an artificial into intelligence by aiming to separate mind from body and eventually uploading mind into an artificial medium. Such an attempt at artificially separating mind and matter not only enhances fragmentation and disorder, but its trajectory contradicts the evolutionary trend of convergence, whereby mind and matter complexify together. End of quote. What then about the post-humanist vision? In lieu of transhumanism's endless belief in the betterment of human capacities, post-humanism seeks to facilitate relationality, belonging, and community. In that project, embodiment, rather than an obstacle, is a needed asset. Borrowing from what might be called new materialists, Professor Delio rightly intuits that, quote, mind is always already material, and matter is necessarily something of the mind, end quote. This is a highly important insight, and its significance can't be overestimated. Let me elaborate on it. Scientifically speaking, the integral link between what we still call mind and matter is a key to understanding the nature of human nature and thus the future of humanity. The reason that I often in my writings put the two terms, mind and matter, in quotation marks is this. In our scientific understanding of the world and cosmos, we have come to a point in which the categorical distinction between the physical material and non-physical non-material has become highly problematic. Just consider the fact that at the moment we do not know what the cosmos is made of. In other words, we can't name, let alone know, what is the smallest something, perhaps infinitely small vibrating something, of which the cosmos is made of. It looks like not only energy, but also information is totally embedded in what we name the mind and matter. In sum, a flight from biological physical dimension hardly is the way to the future as transhumanism envisions, contra posthumanism. When it comes to Christian philosophy and theology of human nature, theological anthropology, with all the alignment during history with Hellenistic dualisms, an essentially integral relationship between the mental and embodiment is the default position. Or why else would we wait for the resurrected life, which in turn requires some kind of correspondence with the current order of life in this world? Otherwise, resurrection doesn't make any sense. Bodily resurrection doesn't make any sense. Some transhumanists mistaken reference to Christian vision of eternal life as a flight from the biological physical order is just that, namely a mistake. As a result, post-humanism's goal of a new type of relational person emerging in and through information embeddedness is much closer to the Christian vision than that of transhumanism. It is also key to relationality, communion, and belonging, summarizes Professor Delia, and I quote, "Relationality, not betterment, is the operative word of post-human life. Humans are part of a deep relational wholeness that is characteristic of nature itself," end quote. Defeated, thereby, is the modernist liberal vision of individuality without belonging and independence apart from interrelationality. This is one of the most important insights of the presentation under consideration, and I couldn't endorse it more enthusiastically. In this vision, cognition, thinking, rationality does not leave behind human embodied and relational thinking. They complement and perhaps even challenge each other, but they ought not to be equated or considered as alternatives. Enter Teilhard de Chardin. What then is the problem with, or perhaps the liability of, posthumanism? What, if anything, is lacking in the posthumanist vision? Professor Delio puts it this way. Granted that relationships are essential and shape the personhood, what is the ultimate end? For what purpose? Where is the ultimate meaning of the world and human life to be found? The standard scientific evolutionary theory, based on a flat ontology with no allowance for transcendence, fails to give an answer. Evolution thereby is trapped into a meaningless random process. Even if directional, at least in the functional sense, evolution does not allow for the ultimate meaning. It is here that the French paleontologist, theologian and cultural figure Pierre Teilhard-Chardin enters the conversation. Teilhard's vision of the omega point provides the needed surplus. Evolution is on the way to something more, something higher. Call it the end, as in gold reached. What makes Teilhard's vision so compelling is that while he was religious himself, alongside some other thinkers, such as Henri Bergson, he believed this goal-oriented evolutionary capacity is not necessarily supernatural, but rather something innate in nature. Hear me rightly. According to Teilhard, if I'm not mistaken, God is not needed as the source of this meaningful evolution, although Jesuit himself, of course, believed God is the source. He named God as Omega. But along with new materialists, Teilhard considered the matter as deeply informed. Embedded in the physical is information, hence transcendence is allowed and affirmed. The Jesuit names the ultimate goal of evolution as love, as we heard. God is love. Therefore, in Teilhard's opinion, God must create cosmos in order to be able to share love. Among contemporary theologians, Jürgen Moltmann has championed the same kind of view. Without creation, reciprocity, no love is possible. Here I wish to add a critical note. Differently from Teilhard and Moltmann, and in alignment with Karl Barth and Wolfgang Pannenberg, I argue that God is not in need of this world in order to be completely a God. In his eternal Trinitarian love, there is a sharing and mutuality. Only after God has created the cosmos, out of God's infinite outpoured love, mutuality is in order. Related, I do not find very useful Teilhard's talk about theogenesis. Even gratuitously understood, it gives wings to misunderstanding. I would like to hear more about these two liabilities in Teilhard's thought from Professor Delio. In her presentation, Professor suffices to report Teilhard's view of love and theogenesis, and I would like to hear some more thoughts on that. I would also like to hear more from the presenter concerning Teilhard's fascinating idea of some kind of, I would call it collective global mind, coming together of individual minds. Maybe my terminology is not very helpful, but what is the meaning of the new sphere? What exactly means the Jesuits' idea that this single thinking envelope comprised of all living minds on Earth is deeply rooted in the biosphere and at the same time distinct from it? Is it an affirmation of the embodied nature of human thinking, as I understand Professor Telio also interpreting the Chardin? If so, then it is vastly different from the vision of Frank Tipler and other transhumanists, disembodied, non-biological machinist computed vision of afterlife. Furthermore, it would be enlightening to have Professor Delio further develop this vision of a planetary brain in light of so many dramatic scientific and technological developments that have taken place after Teilhard-Chardin first suggested it. A related question arises in my mind. Would Teilhard's collective global mind intuit something similar to Tipler's infinite expansion of the cybernetic intelligence all over the universe, not only on this Earth, but all over the universe? And if so, what might be the implications? And I don't know if they have any parallelism with each other. Furthermore, again, after so much has happened since Teilhard's life, what would his vision of the ultra-human, hyper-personal mean in the third millennium? As Professor explained to us, it is not about making us perfect, but what exactly would it mean in terms of our future? And what would religion look like in that kind of post-humanistic existence? If it means a transition from individual personhood to some kind of shared planetary collectivism, I'm getting somewhat nervous in light of the Christian vision of eternal life. For me, Christian tradition, I interpret Christian tradition to maintain individual personhood, even in the very context of a deep union with God and in an unbroken communion with other persons. Finally, and perhaps somewhat surprisingly, I would love to get some more clarification to what I take is a main claim of Professor Delia's paper and also an ending of her talk. The last sentence of the manuscript that I am following says, Teilhard's vision helps us realize that religion is the most crucial factor for AI in the 21st century. Without it, we will be left fearful and vulnerable. End quote. Could you help me understand more deeply and widely the basis for this profound statement, with which I, of course, would wholeheartedly agree, provided it is true? What I mean is this. While deeply religious himself, as mentioned, it seems to me Teilhard made every effort to articulate his unique, bold vision for the future of humanity in a way that would not necessarily need a religious commitment. He himself was deeply religious, but I think he wanted to recommend this post-humanist vision even for those who are not coming from a theistic perspective. And I wonder how many among those who advocate the AI project would concur with the claim that religion is the most crucial factor, and if they do, on what basis? Thank you.